Death is outside life, but it alters it. It leaves a hole in the fabric of things, which those who are left behind try to repair. Perhaps it's because of this we are minded to feast at funerals, and it is said that certain children are conceived on the eve of a departure, lest the separation of the partners be permanent. When, in ancient stories, heroes die, the first thing their comrades do, having made due observance to the gods, is sit and eat. Then they travel on, challenging with their frail vitality the large enigma of non-being. Now, there are two reasons why I've retained a special fondness for that paragraph. The first is that when I first produced the manuscript as a brand new writer, it was the paragraph I was advised to take out. I didn't take it out, thus proving the truth of Jung's maxim, which is that you should never give advice, but it's seldom dangerous as people rarely take it. What my publishers disliked was that opening word, death, which is rather ironic because it's the subject I've become rather known for, and hence the kind invitation here today. And the second, less trivial reason for my fondness for this paragraph is that this subject, death, is, I have come to see, a blueprint for everything that I was subsequently to write. I really owed that first paragraph of Miss Garnet's Angel to thinking about a comment of Wittgenstein's. Wittgenstein said, "Death is not an event in life. We do not live to experience death." As Wittgenstein points out, being alive renders death one of the very few things which remains wholly barred to human knowledge. So, he goes on to suggest, there is no point in our fearing it. And yet, we do fear death, not least because of the hole it makes in our lives when someone close to us dies. And of course, as has even more famously been said, along with taxes, death is the one thing we can be sure of. We are dying. We are dying. We are all of us dying, D.H. Lawrence says in his fine poem, The Ship of Death. We are dying. Piecemeal, our bodies are dying. And Lawrence, incidentally, died only a few months of TB after writing that poem, so he did know what he was talking about. But he also goes on to talk about another sort of death, what he calls the long and painful death that lies between the old self and the new. And this other sort of death, what we might call a psychic death, turned out also to be part of the theme of Miss Garnet's Angel and the books which have followed it. The novel starts with the word which my publishers so disliked, death, and discusses it in the paragraph I've just read in the abstract. But the paragraph that follows the one I've quoted continues the theme, but more specifically. It suggests how death affects the life of one particular person, Julia Garnet. When Miss Garnet's friend Harriet died, Miss Garnet decided to spend 6 months abroad. So, here we have death, not merely as an ending, but also a beginning. Death as the word that starts the novel, and death the subject, Harriet's death, becoming the catalyst for my heroine Miss Garnet's new life. That this is one less obvious but common effect of death is an observation that arises out of my own previous life. And there is much to be said about the way there are many small deaths along the way as we live and refashion our own lives. As Chrissy said earlier, I used to work as a Jungian psychotherapist, very often with bereaved people. They came to me usually mourning some kind of grievous loss. This was sometimes a physical death, but it might be another kind of loss of a significant other, which is often experienced as death. But frequently, though by no means always, the hole which the loss had made in their lives enabled some sort of new life to enter in. New possibilities arose from the space made by what had been taken away. Now, of course, one must be very wary of making that sort of Pollyanna-type judgment. All bad things have good outcomes if you wait long enough. Well, they don't, not always. And anyway, the new something which may arise doesn't lessen the shock or ameliorate the horror of the loss. All I want to observe is that the loss has consequences. Nature abhors a vacuum, and quite certainly, new things began to happen to my Miss Garnet, though she does set them in motion herself by making that, for her, gigantic step, going alone, a retired schoolteacher, a spinster, very reserved, to spend 6 months in Venice. While she is in Venice, the second sort of death mentioned by Lawrence begins to occur, that long and painful death that lies between the old self and the new. This other death begins for Julia Garnet when, for the first time, she falls in love, unsuitably, as is so often the case. Discombobulated by her strange new environment and her recent loss, she falls in love, as some of you may know, with a man who, in fact, has designs on the young Italian boy she has befriended. So she is not only humiliated by the realization that her love is not requited, but by the added mortification of finding that the object of her impassioned love is a predatory pedophile. But, and here again, my past as a psychotherapist came to my aid. This very shocking experience is the thin end of a wedge which splits open her very repressed persona, her atheism, her rationality, her overweening common sense. All these come to be radically challenged through this second upset of her emotional life, this turning around, this death of her way of looking at things. Now, this idea of dying to the old self is, of course, as old as the hills. It is exemplified in one of Jesus's many sayings on the subject. Except a grain of wheat fall into the ground and die, it abideth alone. But if it die, it bringeth forth much fruit. In Julia Garnet's case, she suffers what she herself recognizes as a breakdown. But Jesus, not a bad psychologist, suggests a breakdown can be creative. For one thing, it often allows for a recognition of otherness, other people's otherness, one's own otherness, or the otherness of parts of life we have been blind to. Adrift in her misery, aware now of other states of being and feeling, Julia Garnet begins to experience a strange and haunting presence, a spiritual dimension which he has formerly rubbished. Here she is reflecting on the meaning of her breakdown. Certainly she had suffered a derangement. And was it this, she wondered, chopping basil into the simmering sauce, to which she had added just a dash of vinegar, a pinch of sugar, that had brought about the acute and astonishing experience as she had walked out of the chapel that day into the sunlight? The sight itself of this, she was wholly sure, was not the stuff of madness. But maybe a kind of madness had been necessary to pull apart her faculties of perception. To let the light in, she concluded, pouring steaming scarlet sauce over green ribbons of pasta. And the Leonard Cohen fans among you will recognize that I have nicked that phrase to let the light in from him. An interesting side note about the creative process. It was only when I came to read this particular passage aloud, long after the book was published, that I noticed Miss Garnet's reflection was accompanied by cooking, as if the seed of that very first paragraph, where I tell how in ancient stories men sit after a death and eat, had lain dormant in my mind and put out shoots without my consciously noticing it. One element of Miss Garnet's new creativity is her appetite, her readiness to devour, her readiness to feed herself on nourishing food. Now, another thing I noticed when I came to talk about the book was how key the figure of Miss Garnet's dead friend Harriet became. Harriet's death sets the whole action going, and yet, in one important sense, we never meet her. She isn't a flesh and blood character, only a recurring illusion. But in a strange way, as the story develops, she comes to life within the consciousness of Julia Garnet. So it makes psychological sense, as well, I hope, narrative sense, when we meet her again at the very end of the book. This coming to life of Harriet, I came to recognize, is the co-relative of Julia Garnet's own inner growth. As Julia begins to recover from the death of her old self, she begins to know her friend for the first time, so that the dead Harriet is, in a sense, more alive to her than she had been when living. One tangible token through which Harriet lives on is her hat, a hat that Julia, on what appears to be an impulse, takes with her to Venice, not quite recognizing how useful it will prove to be, both as a reminder of her old friend and a valuable protection against the chill winds she encounters, both real and metaphoric. There was a cold wind as she marched back down the Calle Lunga, and she pulled down the veil of Harriet's hat. Its fine mesh made a protection against the blast on her face, and she found there was a further comfort in it, for behind her veil she could look out at passers-by without herself being scrutinized. What would Harriet have made of her friend falling so passionately and, it must be said, so unsuitably in love at this time in her life? It was ironic when you thought how it was she who had always been charging Harriet with unsuitability. Had Harriet ever been in love, she wondered? She would not now be surprised to learn that there had been a secret lover in Harriet's life. There was the question over the dyed hair, and her companion had displayed certain other signs, a tendency to drink too much sherry, a penchant for unusual hats and handbags, a taste for romantic fiction. She had mocked Harriet's Bills and Boone library books. The bitterness of the wind off the Alps made tangible for her now the bitterness of her own remorse. Under the guise of common sense, she had cut Harriet down to size, a hideous turn of phrase, as she now saw it. Shuddering at her own deficiencies as much as at the February winds, she came once more to the edge of the piazza, and there was the basilica, more powerful than in memory. The big-bellied roofs, the color of opaque crystal, the wings of the angels gleaming as they mounted ever upward to the cloud-packed sky. Why, this is love too, thought Julia Garnet. The dead friend, lying dormant in Julia Garnet's mind, coupled with the shock of failure, has produced, like Jesus's grain of corn, a vital growth. And this relates to another feature of my work, which is also connected to the ways in which the seemingly dead past can be taken up and reprocessed within the present and produce more life. This happens both at the individual level and at the collective level. And this is the reason that I'm fascinated by old stories. What interests me about old stories is their evolutionary quality, their ability to survive. I am sure that when they do, and of course by definition we don't know when they don't, it is because they distill and embody timeless truths, the quintessential data of human consciousness, which are invariant to time and place and culture. The story of Tobias and the angel, for example, which I tell alongside the contemporary story of Julia Garnet, tells of how the pious Jew Tobit, in exile, sends his son to faraway Medea to collect a family debt. With his son, he sends a serving man named Azarias, except he is not a serving man at all. He is the archangel Raphael, one of the seven angels who fly in and out before the face of the Holy One. This story was first written down as part of the Jewish scriptures around 150 BC, but indisputably it was part of a much older oral tradition and was told and retold for centuries before, being in fact part of an ancient Median Persian story, far older than the Jewish scriptures. And it has since been reprised in numerous works of art, painting, sculpture, plays, opera, up to my novel of Miss Garnet today. What has come to interest me is how these recurring tales connect us, for example, to the exiled Jews in 722 BC, or the ancient Medeans, to the Homeric Greeks, or the first Christians, or the pagan Danes. These stories are kept alive within a kind of constantly renewing stream of consciousness, which expresses itself at different times in different media, but act to keep something vital, which might otherwise have died, alive inside us. This kind of cultural recurrence is paralleled within the individual psyche, when those who are dead, or in other ways lost to us, are kept alive in our memories. And this is why, in an important sense, the dead don't die. The even more mysterious thing is that, just as an old story is revitalized when it is retold, so do the individual dead undergo a kind of sea change as we remember them. And remember that remember means remember, i.e. put together again. This is another insight gleaned from my work as a therapist, the way that the lost or dead become transformed within the consciousness of the living. This kind of life after death happens not in some other spirit world, but in the enduring world of the consciousness of the survivors. The dead haunt us, not necessarily in any spooky sense, but in our ordinary lives. Think how the people you have known are still influencing your thoughts and actions. A person, says Bridget, the wife of the dead Peter, in my second novel, Instances of the Number Three, a person isn't merely a thing of flesh and blood. A person lives inside us, informing how we think and feel. Bridget says these words to Frances, her dead husband's mistress, and the book describes how these two women learned the truth of the man they both loved and crucial truths about themselves after his death. The dead man, Peter, comes back in the form of a ghost. Now, why did I do that? Because it seemed to me, taking my cue from the old tales I love so much, that ancient cultures project certain states in an outward form where we nowadays introject them. The gods and goddesses, angels and spirits, ghosts and phantoms of older cultures are merely that culture's way of giving form to intangible realities, which we tend in our modern day, much less colorfully, to internalize and phrase psychologically. Just as angels are a time-honored way of defining those moments of otherness, when someone or something seems to touch our being with more than ordinary mortal significance, so a ghost may be one way of dramatizing those elements of a person which linger on when their physical body has died. I was wanting to work with Shakespeare's tale of Hamlet, an old tale which he had already reworked, which famously begins with a ghost. Unlike Hamlet's ghost, however, my ghost, Peter, does not come back in order to command revenge. He comes back with a plea for forgiveness, something which he is much in need of, for he has betrayed both the women who loved him. And as the ghost of the dead man and his wife converse, the nature of each begins to shift. Human consciousness has a remarkable capacity for transformation, and it is, in fact, probably what most distinguishes us from other animals. And who or what people are is essentially how they are registered in the consciousness of others. In important ways, who or what I am lies as much in how I affect you as in my own estimation of my worth and character, in fact, probably rather more. Human reality turns out to be really rather fluid. The dead flow into the living, informing, as Bridget says, how the living think and feel. And in that process, the dead are changed, sometimes quite radically. I think this is because death is a kind of conscious shock in which the irrelevant parts of people, the husks, as it were, of their personalities, are winnowed, and the grain, the essential element, becomes revealed. This has something to do with the alchemical action of memory, which, as we know, both refashions and fabricates, but not necessarily in a spirit of untruthfulness. The dead Peter comes back to be remembered by his wife so that she and her capacity to forgive him become the creative force which form his final destiny, what in him finally becomes real. Memory is an extraordinary element in human consciousness because it is what forms our sense of history. Notoriously, we only live in the past. As Kierkegaard said, it is life's tragedy that it can only be understood backwards, and yet it must be lived forwards. Memory is the space in between where what we have been and been through recurs and is recapitulated, reflected upon, so that the past is in fact constantly undergoing renewal and change. My fourth novel, The Other Side of You, develops this notion of death as both agent and recipient of creative change. And of all my novels, it's probably the one which tackles the theme of life and death most head-on. The narrator is both a psychiatrist and a psychoanalyst, my own former career, whose specialization is suicides. The reason for this is explained in the opening chapter. And here, David McBride, the narrator, tells how his own history has informed his choice of career. When I was 5, my brother Jonathan was killed by an articulated lorry. It was my 3rd day of school, and our mother was unwell. And because our school was close by, and my brother was advanced for his 6.5 years, and was used to going to and from school alone, she allowed him to take me there unescorted. The one road we had to cross was a minor one, but the lorry driver had mistaken his way and was backing round the corner as a preliminary to turning round. Johnny had stepped off the pavement and had his back to the lorry to beckon me across. Although he was mature for his age, he was small, too small to figure in the mirror's sight lines. I was on the pavement, and I watched him vanish under the reversing lorry, and I seemed to remember, though this could be the construction of hindsight, that it was not until the vehicle started forward that I heard a thin, high scream, the sound I imagine a rabbit might make as a trap springs fatally on fragile bones. I doubt there was a bone left unbroken in my brother's body when the lorry drove off, leaving the mess of shattered limbs and blood and skin which had been Johnny. I believe I saw what was left of him before I was whirled away in the big freckled arms of Mrs. Whelan, who lived across the street and had heard the scream and rushed me into her house, which Johnny and I had never liked because it smelled of dismally cooked food, and terrified me by falling on her knees and dragging me down with a confused, "Jesus, Mary and Joseph, the blessed Lamb, may he rest in peace." Afterwards, I didn't know where my brother was, but I was pretty sure it wasn't with Jesus, Mary, or Joseph. The belief I clung to was that Johnny was still in the pine tree he had assured me was magic, on whose stately curving boughs we used to swing together in the park. I heard him more than once when I was allowed back to play there. He was singing, "He'll be coming round the mountain when he comes," which was the song our mother sang when we were fretful, the two of us, on long car journeys. Later, when my mother had my twin sisters, born one behind the other within the hour, she sang other songs to them. For a long time, I was expecting my lost brother to come round that mountain with all the confidence with which he had stepped off the curb of the pavement and into the lorry's fatal path. He was my closest companion, my hero, my single most important attachment to life. And when he didn't come, and I heard only the echo of his voice in my ear as I swung alone on the low pine branch, pretending, for my mother's sake, that I was enjoying myself, a part of me wanted to go after him for company. This is another, less often discussed, aspect of death, its seductive power, its power to detain us from life. The death of David McBride's brother, Johnny, has left him with a problem of commitment to life. As he later says of his own profession, "The people we were treating were not so much looking for a remedy for anxiety or depression. They were looking for a reason to be alive. For the most part, the human race takes for granted that life, if not a blessing, is at least desirable enough to cling to. But for those for whom the business of being alive is a much more vexed question, the illness is the question. Or, put it another way, the illness is how the question will often be posed. For these hesitant souls, it is life and not death that holds the terrors. And if I recognized the feeling, it was because I shared it." David McBride has managed to turn the wound of his loss into a creative skill, but he remains what I call in the book a hinterland person until he encounters the patient who alters the whole tenor of his life, an attempted suicide, Elizabeth Cruikshank. I was stuck on this book, and it was while I was here in Melbourne, where I was talking about my previous book, Mr. Golightly's Holiday, a book which also has an important death at its center, that I found my clue to what The Other Side of You was to be about. By chance, a psychoanalytical colleague of mine, Neville Symington, was here giving a series of talks on the practice of psychotherapy. He was speaking about what happens when two people face each other in a room, and how the dialogue that ensues can become something which we call treatment, and how between the two people, a third and transformative reality emerges. As he was speaking, there came into my mind an old tale, one that is told in the Gospel of St. Luke, but strikes me as being, once again, a far older tale which Luke has adapted and pressed into service. It's the story of the two disciples 3 days after the death of the man they have loved and followed, in despair, walking to a little village west of Jerusalem called Emmaus. As they walk and talk of their great loss, they are joined by a stranger who walks alongside them, and his presence mysteriously alters their mood. When they reach their destination, a humble inn, so attached have they become to the stranger's presence that they urge him to dine with them. He does so, and when he breaks bread, they suddenly recognize him as their lost friend, newly come to life, at which point he suddenly vanishes. This old story, which popped into my mind here in Melbourne, struck me as an extraordinarily speaking image for what happens between two people whose hearts and minds are sufficiently open to the truth. A third reality emerges between them, more powerful and more distinctive than the sum of their two individual realities. And it was my clue to the story of David McBride and his suicidal patient. The ancient story of the journey to Emmaus became both the image for what was to occur between David McBride and his patient, the growth of a third, more powerful reality, which transforms both their parts, past, and a crucial part of her story. I shan't spell out here what it was that had driven this woman to try and take her life, not least because if you've not read the book, I'd like you to buy and read it. But it has the consequence that for her too, it was not death that was to be feared, but life. One of David's mantras learned from his friend and mentor, Gus Galen, is, "There is no cure for being alive, but, as Elizabeth points out, there is a cure, death. Death as a solution for life, a dissolution of the self. Death as an existential rest. And in fact, it's not so unusual to be, as Keats put it, half in love with easeful death." I was recently rereading Catherine Mansfield's journals, and I was struck by her response to her beloved brother, who was killed in World War I. Like David McBride, like Elizabeth Cruikshank, death for Catherine Mansfield, because it had taken the beloved, became itself the desired object. She writes, "I want to write down the fact that not only am I not afraid of death, I welcome the idea of death. I believe in immortality because he is not here and I long to join him. Other people are near, but they are not close to me. To you only do I belong. Nobody knows how often I am with you. Indeed, I am always with you." Catherine Mansfield has been in my mind because I've just published a collection of short stories published out in England, not out until December here, and she's the past mistress of the short story. And I'm going to close with one of those at the end, but before I get there, let me dwell a little on two of my other death-delivering or death-deliverancing novels, Where Three Roads Meet, and then my most recent novel, Dancing Backwards. Where Three Roads Meet tells the story of the dying Sigmund Freud, visited in the last months of his life by a strange presence who may or may not be a product of Freud's dream life or the effect of the occasional doses of morphine he's obliged to take for the terrible pain of the cancer in his jaw. Although I'm a Jungian by training, I've always had an admiration for Freud, for his indomitable stubbornness and his mordant wit. His friends had to persuade him to leave Vienna, even though his books were being burned by the Nazis, and quite shortly after he actually left, his three sisters were sent to the concentration camps. And his high-placed friends persuaded him to go, but before he was allowed to leave, the Nazis required him to sign a statement saying how well they had treated him, and he wrote, "I can recommend the Gestapo heartily to anyone." Fortunately, as we know, the Nazis didn't have much sense of humor. This stranger in my story materializes as Tiresias, the blind soothsayer from the myth of Oedipus, and he has come to tell Freud how it really was in the story that Freud hijacks to form the plank of his new system of psychoanalysis, the so-called Oedipus complex. But Freud also formulated, later in his life, a theory of the so-called death drive, which according to Freud stands in opposition to the erotic drive, the idea being, which shared by Catherine Mansfield, shared by David McBride, that each of us, all human beings ultimately, struggle against an inherent desire for total oblivion and quiescence. We know that Freud himself had from a young age greatly feared death, which made his last 16 months of painful struggle against cancer that much more poignant. So I sent my mythic priest, Tiresias, who served at the Delphic Oracle, where Apollo pronounced his famously ambiguous prophecies, partly to open Freud's mind to the fuller meaning of the myth, in which Tiresias is a key player, because much as I admired Freud the man, I never much cared for his interpretation of that great myth, because he seemed to have missed so many important factors in it. And I think part of my purpose in writing the book was to kind of play a little with setting him straight about what it was really about. But Tiresias, it transpired as the novel developed, was also there to lead him out of life towards an oblivion which is more than an obliteration. Tiresias, in retelling the old story of Oedipus, shows Freud how Oedipus is not significant so much because he killed his father and married his mother, which we're all doing that, but because suffering as he does, blinded by his own hand, a homeless misfit and a filthy social outcast, he reaches a point where through sheer bloody endurance, he becomes holy. And here is Tiresias telling Freud about the last days of Oedipus. But you, Dr. Freud, who have traveled so far with death at your side and have charted better than any the perpetual temptation of our own quiescence, have missed something vital. Oedipus renounced the wish to die, even knowing at last who he was and what he had done. As legitimate child and prince of the land, he was taken from his mother's bed, cruelly crippled and ruthlessly sentenced to death on the cold breast of Kithaeron. Bearing the marks of death, he met his own death-dealing father at that fatal junction on the Delphi Road, and refusing to suffer a second time the imprint of his violence, killed him with his own staff, before he came to take his father's place as ruler of the city which had bred him, to lie for a second time on the soft breast of its queen. Yet, in his passionate pursuit of the truth, he robbed himself of that return, of the welcome, and now welcoming breast, and honored place of high standing, to sentence himself an outcast again, a wanderer on the face of the earth, feeling his way by the means of the fatal weapon which had brought him to this pass. But the wonder of it is that this was not the end. The worst of men lived to become the best of men. That unwillingness to yield, which took his father's life and overcame his mother's, saw Oedipus to a hero's end. Oedipus, as the myth and Tiresias tell us, doesn't die. He is finally taken up by the gods as a hero from the holy sanctuary of the Eumenides, who were once the persecuting furies who pursue Orestes across the face of the earth for the crime of killing his mother, Clytemnestra. But they have been transformed into the kindly ones, and in just the way Oedipus's apparently doomed fate becomes transformed by his own resilience and courage into a kindly, numinous one, I have my Freud, rather naughtily perhaps, also transformed, so that like Oedipus, he does not die at the end of my book, but rather moves on, taking the elusive third road of the book's title, accompanied by his mythic friend, Tiresias. This kind of transformation, which in the ancient stories takes an outer form, I try to convey using a mixture of old stories and modern psychology, both within the interpersonal relationships, interpersonal being between two people, and intrapersonal being within the individual self. It is, in fact, I believe, the purpose of psychoanalysis, which is why I felt I wanted to make this also happen for Freud. The past is not incorrigible. Just as the future is, the past is capable of transformation, which is the theme of my most recent novel, Dancing Backwards. Schopenhauer observed that partings were a foretaste of death, and this is a novel about a parting which has looked like a death, and the resolution of that parting. Once again, it is about memory and the power of memory to be reformed, and thus to reform the past, so that what appears to be dead is informed, or rather reinformed, with new life. Violet Hetherington, recently widowed, is on a voyage across the Atlantic to meet Edwin, the friend she believes she has betrayed. The betrayal is bound up with a serious life error she has made, a disastrous romantic attachment to a friend of Edwin's, Bruno. The affair leads to her apparent betrayal of her old friend at his hour of need. And this betrayal is only part of the far more serious betrayal of herself. In fact, this novel is the culmination of all the previous five novels, because it is the novel which deals most centrally with the ways in which we can betray ourselves and our deepest creative impulses, a betrayal which can lead to an inner death. Violet, under Edwin's benign tutelage, became a promising young poet, a career which she allows to be mutilated and apparently destroyed through the envy of her lover, later her husband. Nearly 40 years have passed before we find her making her journey to America on a cruise liner full of distractions, which, in the way of things, become clues to Violet's own reprieve. As she hears the stories of her fellow passengers and learns to dance, she revisits her past, and the past begins to alter, imperceptibly at first, and then more radically. What in the other side of you I try to explore as the coming to life of a third reality between two people. In this novel, I explore as the coming to life of the alienated and defeated self. There is one character in this book which in some ways distills the essence of all my writing. I call it the voice, and it's the part of ourselves that knows the score, knows what is what, and which we all too often ignore or defy to our detriment. Like the dead Harriet as the book progresses and Violet journeys across the water, the voice takes on strength. Here's the voice towards the end of the novel. Violet has met Edwin again and learned that things were not as she had thought them or believed she thought them. She no longer minded that Bruno had been faithless, nor did she mind Edwin's revelation. It had come as no real surprise. In her bones, she had known it, or known something like it. What Bruno's sexual proclivities were didn't matter now. What mattered was the part she had played in her own catastrophe. "You knew all along," the voice said. "You always do." But she hadn't listened. "Why not?" the voice asked. "Why do you not listen to me, to us?" So there was more than one of them. "Of course," said the voice. "What do you expect? You can't run a republic single-handed." She got out of bed to run a bath and lay looking at her legs covered in geranium-scented foam. She had enjoyed using them to dance. "That's the stuff," the voice said. "Song and dance. Make hay while the sun shines. A little of what you fancy does you good." "You seem to have resorted to cliché," she admonished. "What's wrong with cliché?" said the voice. "Clichés are home truths. Least said, soon is mended. Time and tide wait for no man. Fine words butter no parsnips." "Oh, shut up." "Wise up," said the voice. "Charity begins at home." Which leaves me only a scrap of time to mention Aphrodite's Hat, my new collection of short stories. The form of the short story is a kind of reiterated death, and at least three stories in this collection are face-on about death. One, the title story, Aphrodite's Hat, with this lovely painting by Cranach, which is the focus of the story. You see why it's called Aphrodite's Hat. She's stark naked except for her hat. Is about mortal illness, and quite a few are about partings, Schopenhauer's foretaste of death. But two of them are about that perilous form of immortality, which we call art, which paradoxically may be the one way we have to defeat death. Because art brings life and death together in a form which itself outlives the life of its creators, who may themselves never know how they have contributed to their own immortality and our sense of the abiding value of life. I mentioned Keats earlier, and I'm going to read the final part of the last story in the book, which concerns Keats, who died tragically young, unaware that his poems would make his name forever famous. It's called The Fall of the Sparrow, which is an allusion to Hamlet's "There's a special providence in the fall of the sparrow," which in turn is an allusion to Luke, thus rather neatly tying up all my previous allusions, which I hadn't intended. And it is, I suppose, about the way in which art can console us for the rash act of being alive. The principal character in this story is a young woman who many years earlier has started an affair with a married man, as young women will do. In this particular case, it is she who has prevented him from leaving his wife. But the affair has gone on, and he finally finds he's unable to leave his wife. She's got to know him as her teacher. She's gone as a graduate, as a mature student, to do a university degree, and he has taught her romantic poetry, in particular Keats. So it's through Keats she has got to know him. "I think I may die," she had said. She delivered her bleak pronouncement to a sparrow, which had flown down and perched on the balcony rail beside her. Keats had liked sparrows. "If a sparrow come before my window, I take part in its existence and pick about the gravel," he had written. It was the same letter where he had asserted, "I am certain of nothing but the holiness of the heart's affections." Keats had brought her into this hopeless situation, but he died in pain, believing he was unloved. On an impulse, Rebecca booked a holiday in Rome. It was raining when she arrived at the sequestered so-called Protestant cemetery, just outside a remainder of the old walls of ancient Rome. She wandered along the grassy paths in the rain-dark light till she found what she was looking for, Keats' gravestone, on which was carved his own forlorn epitaph. "Here lies one whose name was writ in water." The words he wrote and requested be his final memorial just before he died, far from home and his beloved, in humble lodgings on the Spanish Steps. She stood there, astonished that there was nothing more to indicate the abiding genius of the 27-year-old poet who believed that his poems would be as ephemeral as his life. The rain had begun to fall more heavily when she heard a voice. "You will catch cold." A pale young man had apparently followed her to the graveside. "Come under the tree." He gestured towards a tall pine, and they stood together, he holding his coat over their heads. He was smaller than Rebecca and slighter, so that to cover her head he had to stretch. His coat was rather worn and of an old-fashioned cloth and cut. "Why have you come here?" he asked. He looked as if he might have suffered a long illness. "I saw a sparrow," she said. "It made me think of Keats." "You like Keats?" His dark eyes and his thin face were brightly inquiring. He liked sparrows. He wrote to a friend once, "If a sparrow come before my window, I take part in its existence and pick about the gravel." "Yes," the pale young man agreed. "You are right. He did love birds. There aren't many sparrows left in London these days. I thought how Keats might have minded. So you came here." "I wanted to die," she said. "So I came here." "Oh, you mustn't die," he said. And he looked at her with such urgency in his eyes that she had to look away. "Believe me, no one is worth dying for." Side by side they stood, so close that she felt the shadow of his breath on her cold cheek. As the rain eased, a sparrow fluttered down and perched delicately on the tombstone. "Look," she whispered to her companion. Turning to him, she found there was no one beside her but the pine tree, and the only breath, a faint stirring of the wind. Thank you.